good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending upon where you are around the world. This is our regular time to get together as a community and to explore the psychology and the strategies of moving from ordinary to extraordinary so that you can have an entire life and business turnaround by understanding, first and foremost, the psychology and developing the mindset necessary and then applying the strategies of ultimate performance, mastery, genius, greatness. So before we get into the topic today, which is about focus, a really important topic, and actually, you know, what else is new, but I might push some buttons today because very few people have a tremendous amount of focus. It's unfortunate, but it's true. Before we do that, though, I want you just to weigh in, as you always do. If you just say hello, tell me where you're watching from around the world. That's always fun for me and important for me to know where our community is growing. And it is growing worldwide, and I really, truly appreciate you for being here. And I really intend to give you 10 times more value than what you expect every single week. Because put this in your notes, winners always provide 10 times more value than what they ask in return. And when you do that, you will become a massive winner, not just in 2017, but for the rest of your days. Now, a couple housekeeping items. We are giving you a gift for the month of January. It's called How to Have Your Best Year Ever. It's normally a $197 package program system, and it's absolutely yours free. For putting in the coupon code, you should see that somewhere above my head. Just click the link and it'll take you right to the website. You'll click add to cart and make sure and put in your coupon code, which I believe is 2017 gift. Is that right, Bear? Yeah, 2017 gift, and it comes to your inbox free. So take advantage of that and dive deep into it, because my great wish and intention is to help you have your very best year ever up to this point. And then we'll talk about 2018 when we get there. Also, if you've missed past episodes, this is episode, what is this, Bear? This is episode number 23, 24, Bear saying it's 24, I think it's 23, but she's probably right, because details are not my thing. So, it's episode 20-something, and if you haven't seen all of them, she's giving me the evil Persian eye and going, four, behind the camera, because that's how she rolls. But nonetheless, you know, if you haven't seen all of them, then go to jamesray.com/live-cast, jamesray.com/live-cast, and they're all chronicled there, they're all housed there for your consumption, and it's a lot easier than scrolling forever back through the Facebook feed, even though they're down there somewhere back 23, Bear says 24 episodes ago, but anyway, who's saying what?
Pauline said 24.
Okay, Pauline, the women win. I mean, you know, when you're a guy and you're smart, you let the women win, okay? Guys, are you with me on this? Now, hopefully you're weighing in and telling me where you're from. And let's see, what other housekeeping items before we dive into focus? I want to shout out to members of our community and give a big gratitude shout out for all of you who shared last week. This is a way that you can help me help you help those that you love and care about. Did you get that? Help me help you help those that you love and care about. And all you have to do is just hit the share button. It's really easy here on this wonderful thing we have called Facebook. Pauline Lund did that. Julie Du Bois did that. Josie Haddad, Stan Justin, Renoza Balboa, Balbin, if I get your name wrong, her writing is for shit, all right? She's really smart, she's really talented, but her writing sucks. Devin Dersing, starts with a K. I love you. I love you. Thanks for sharing. I can't read it. Melinda Orbain, Tanya Meinhardt, David Rodriguez, Marta Reyes, Prairie Sky Natural Healings, the Rogers Twins, the Mountain Men, not mountain men like living in the mountain, but like walking mountains, okay? Andrew and Anthony, thanks guys. For sharing, as you always do. Francesco, my friend, Francesco Morisi, thank you for sharing. And Susan Davis, keep it up. I appreciate you being here. Once again, if you have questions or comments, put them down below. I'll do my best to get to them real time if we have time. And if not, as always, I'll come back and answer them in retrospect. That's my promise to you. And I do that every single week. Now, if you're like most, then you set some goals and intentions for 2017. False or true? You know, most people set goals and intentions. Most people have New Year's resolutions. You know, research proves that only 8% of the people who set resolutions actually achieve them. It's unfortunate. Well, we're going to be talking all this month, and, you know, again, the free gift I'm giving you, How to Have Your Best Year Ever, is all about putting you in the 8%, and I know you want to be there. So I know you set some goals and intentions, unless you're just really bizarre, and most people do. And, you know, it's funny because the entirety of life is the process of setting and achieving goals. I had a guy say to me once when I was talking to him about setting goals, he said, James, you know, I've never set a goal in my entire life. Okay, you can't get up in the morning without setting a goal to get up in the morning. When you set your alarm, you're setting a goal to get up in the next morning at a certain time. You can't be to work on time without setting a goal to be to work on time. You can't do anything in life, even the most mundane and simple, without setting a goal to do so. So the entirety of life is about setting and achieving goals. It's just unfortunate that the vast majority of people achieve their mundane goals, but they don't achieve their massive goals. They don't achieve their magical goals. They don't reach their magnificence because they get distracted, quite frankly. They get knocked off course. Their limited programming in their unconscious tells them they're not capable, they're not worthy. They don't have the ability to do so. I could talk about this all day, and I'm not going to do it, but I want to give you some inside tips here as to how you can have a greater propensity, greater probability to be in the 8%. Because that's where I want you to be, and that's where you want to be. I know it is. If you intend to achieve your own level of ultimate performance, then you're going to have to get focused. You're going to have to get into the flow state. Now, there's a lot of research by Mihai Csikszentmihalyi, who wrote the book Flow. And I've had conversations with Mihai Csikszentmihalyi. He's a professor of psychology and business. And you're going to have to get in the flow state. And a flow state is complete immersion in what you're doing. It's a highly spiritual state, right? People want to talk about meditation. Flow is serious, full-on meditation. It's total immersion where you and the object of your attention become one. Where the lines blur and everything else, you've been there. Everything kind of goes away and you go into this tunnel of focus and flow, right? And it's a magical place to be. It's a spiritual, it's a heightened state of awareness because you merge into universal consciousness. And the separation that we set up between ourselves and others and between ourselves and things goes away. And that's where unlimited and infinite intelligence comes through you and magic starts to happen. You know, I've been there when I'm writing. You know, I'm like, bam, 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 bam. And all of a sudden, I haven't eaten lunch and I haven't eaten dinner and it's 2 a.m. in the morning and I'm like, oh my God, Have you been there? You know, and then I read back what I've written and I'm like, oh my God, where did that come from? Well, oh my God is an accurate statement because it's universal intelligence coming through. And if you're going to achieve your goals and you're going to achieve any level of mastery, you're going to have to get into focused flow. Now, the problem is that you and I live in a culture of devastating distraction. Devastating distraction. And I'm not being over dramatic here. Focus is replaced by folly. You know, most people, their focus is so lacking, they can't keep their mind on one train of thought for a couple of minutes, much less an hour. Now, check in with yourself right now and let me ask you, how many times have you checked your Facebook feed? How many times have you checked your email? How many times have you looked at other things on your phone? How many times have you been distracted since we've been carrying on this conversation? And there's no value in lying to yourself. You know, how fully present are you here now with this conversation that can literally transform your life? We're talking about achieving your goals in 2017. We're talking about living the dream in 2017. How focused are you? You know, I was talking to a friend this morning at the gym, and it was obvious to me that she was not present in the workout. I'm like, where are you? Oh, I'm here. No, your body's here. Your mind is elsewhere. Well, I got so much to do today, and I got to do this, and I got to do this. And I'm like, look, look, you're here now. Let's get focused. Be here now. Because you see, when you're not focused and you're not here now, you're not living. It's not real life when your body is present, but your mind and heart and spirit are not. Does that make sense to you? Now, you know, research, not my idea, but research proves that in today's world, we have the attention span of a goldfish. Actually, worse than a goldfish. I'm not making this up. A goldfish has an 8-second attention span. You know what research proves that we have right now? About 6 seconds. And I ask you to check in. How focused are you here with me right now in this conversation? Are you 100% with me? And if you are, just type yes. Because, you know, if you're with me, type yes. Because my bet, and there's no value in lying to yourself, my bet is that you're not. And, you know, the good news is, if you notice that you're not, then recognition is the first law of learning and transformation. You're never, ever, ever going to transform until you recognize that you need to. You with me on this? Now, again, we're inundated every single day with distractions, devastating distractions, distractions like interruptions, text messages, emails, Facebook feeds, social media, fantasy, daydreams, right? Phone calls, searching the internet, idle chit-chat, all kinds of interruptions. I could go on, but because there's more, I'm sure there's more, but I think you get the point. Is there any wonder that most people never even come close to the 8% who achieve their goals that they set at the new year, much less even come close to a level of mastery? Is it any wonder? Now look, you can be a light bulb. A light bulb, what does it do? It doesn't have a lot of focus. It's diffused light. And so it lights up a large amount of space, right? But it doesn't have a whole hell of a lot of power. A laser beam, on the other hand, can cut through steel. Why? White hot bead. Focus. So what are you going to be? Light bulb or laser beam? Now look, let me give you some further research that's going to blow your mind. What research tells us is that the average individual spends an average of 2 hours and 15 minutes per day in distraction. 2 hours and 15 minutes per day in distraction. Now, it's worse than that, though, because studies on flow prove that when you get out of flow, remember, flow is complete immersion, where there's nothing else but you and the object of your attention. When you get knocked out of flow by distraction, we already talked about them, interruptions, Facebook feeds, phone calls, text messages, email notifications, any of those things, chit-chat, if you're in an office space. When you get knocked out of flow, it takes 20 minutes to get back into flow. All right? Now, just stick with me here. We're going to do some simple math. 20 minutes. Every time you're distracted, it takes 20 minutes. And that's assuming that you ever get to flow, right? But you get to the flow state, and you're there. And you're not going, oh my God, I'm in the flow state. Because no, that gets you out of the flow state. You're just, right? Focus flow. Is this flow? Am I in the flow? Is this what James is talking? No, he ain't there. You're in your head. Get out of your head. All right? Get into the object of your attention. Focus. Now, let's say you do get there, meaning that don't. And you get interrupted. It takes you 20 minutes to get back. Minimum. 20 minutes to get back. Now, simple math, because that's how I like it. All right? Imagine that for that 2 hours and 15 minutes that the average individual, and by the way, understand that's the average. So everyone who spends 2 hours and 15 minutes, that means there's someone who spends 4.5 hours in distraction. And there's also someone who spends about an hour in distraction, but the average is 2 hours and 15 minutes. You with me? So for that average, let's just say for simple math that your distraction takes 5 minutes. So you're in flow, and then you get knocked out, and you get knocked out for 5 minutes. Now, research proves it takes 20 minutes to get back. So now, simple math says that's 25 minutes, right? You with me on this? 25 minutes, almost half an hour. Now, let's say that you get 2 of those interruptions per hour for 5 minutes. Right? So 5 minute interruption, 20 minutes to get back, 5 minute interruption, 20 minutes to get back, add it up, that's 50 minutes. All right, that's almost an hour already you've spent in distraction. You see where this is going? Now, let me give you some more statistics. You know, the average individual picks up his or her phone 5 times per hour. Five. And an average, I don't know why Bear's laughing, because, you know, this isn't funny. 5 times per hour. And an average of 100 times per day. All right, now look, you know, I use this for business purposes. I'm using it for my outline right now. And I'm not anti-phone, but let's get real here. All right, 5 times an hour and 100 times per day are not all business. No, you would have a hard time convincing me that that's all business. 100 times per day. Now, I'm sure you can start to see, just with these couple of examples, there's more, but just with these couple of examples, how staggering it is, and why most people never reach the 8%, much less any level of mastery. Let's talk about television. The average individual, watches television 4 hours a day. Now, what's the ROI on that? I'm not anti-television. There's some great things on television. I love to watch documentaries. I love to watch, you know, science. I love to watch cosmology. I love to watch some science fiction because I love things that make me think. But 4 hours a day, there's no way in hell What's the ROI on that? That's the average, which means that there's some people who watch 6 or 8. Now, you know what 4 hours a day of television equates to? That equates to 25% of your waking life. I'm going to break that down for you in a minute and tell you how we come up with that statistic. But I promise you, if you're watching television for 4 hours a day and you go, oh, that's not me, James, I don't do that. Well, just, there's no value in lying to yourself. Just check it out. How many times do you get up in the morning, you flip it on, and you got it running during breakfast while you're getting ready, while you're leaving for the office, and you come home and you flip it on, and you got it running in the background while you're fixing dinner, while you're eating dinner, and you go to bed and you flip it on and you go to sleep and you program your unconscious with that crap before you go to sleep? What's the ROI on that? Be honest with yourself. 25%. If you're watching the average of 4 hours a day, that's 25% of your entire waking life. Let's talk about multitasking. You know, Harvard research now proves that multitasking that was popularized in the 90s actually makes you stupid. You know, when they did the research, they said less intelligent. It makes you scattered and less intelligent to multitask. It's also proven that multitasking and distraction cause you to make poor decisions. And let me tell you how poor they are. They're so poor that they're the equivalent of not sleeping for 24 hours. Now imagine that you don't sleep for 24 hours and you've got to make major decisions. Are you going to be clear? Are you going to be focused? Are you going to be cognizant? Are you going to be intelligent? No, you're not. You're going to be fuzzy and hazy and foggy. And that's what multitasking, right out of Harvard research, is proven to do. You make poor decisions. It makes you less intelligent. It's the equivalent. When you're multitasking and you're distracted, it's the equivalent of missing 24 hours of sleep. You know, please put this in your notes. Multitasking is so 90s. It's so 90s. You know, let it go. Let it go. There's no way you're going to get into flow by multitasking. Ladies, I'm talking to you. All right, I'm talking to everybody, but, you know, ladies are notorious for multitasking. And women are, by the way, according to research, better at it than men, but still yet, it sucks the life out of your potential mastery. Focus is where it's at, baby. Focus is 2017. All right, multitasking is so 90s, so you choose where you're going to be. Now, speaking of losing 24 hours of sleep, do you know, let me give you some more statistics. I hope you're taking notes because you're going to want to go back and review this. You're going to watch this again and review it until it drops into your unconscious and it just becomes integrated and part of who you are. Most people sleep 33% of their entire life away. 33% of their entire life is spent sleeping. You know, people who tell me, oh, I love to sleep, James. I'm going to sleep. Yeah, okay. All right. When you exit this life, what did you accomplish? I slept, baby. You know, man. 33%. That's the average. The average. Which means there's people who sleep more. You know, people who tell me, oh, I just can't function on less than 9 hours or 8 hours. I tell them, sleep faster. Sleep faster. Now, I'm not anti-sleep. You got to get enough sleep or you're not clear. We already talked about this. But you got to get enough sleep. Not too much sleep. There's too much to do. There's too much to accomplish. And the clock is ticking. It's 2017. Right? Before you know it, we're going to be talking, it's 2018. And you know this is true. And you're going to be looking back and going, well, you know, let me revisit those intentions and goals that I set for 2017 because I didn't do shit in 2017 and I fell back into old patterns. And so maybe I'll set those same goals for 2018. 33% of their entire life is spent sleeping. You know, find your sweet spot. For me, it's about 6 hours because 6 hours for me, that gives me 18 hours to produce every single day. Sleep faster. Sleep better. I can help you do that too. Not the purpose of today. Most people have to sleep longer because they don't get good sleep. More statistics. Put this in your notes. The average individual spends 18% of their entire life showering, shaving, fixing their hair, deciding what to wear, deciding what to eat, and eating. 18% of their entire life, your entire life, 18% of your entire life is spent showering, shaving, fixing food, eating, and fixing your hair. Seriously? You come to the end of it all. What did you do? Well, I decided on some good meals and I picked out some nice outfits. And I took some good showers. You know, people say to me all over social media, James, how many black V-necks do you have? How many do I have, Bear?
At least 20.
I'd say at least 30. Why? Because I get rid of mundane decisions. I'm not going to spend 18% of my life deciding what to wear. You know, I promise you I'm wearing a clean shirt every week when you see me. It's not the same V-neck, but I got a bunch of them. And this isn't my idea. I got this right off of Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs had 100 black turtlenecks. 100. When I go into my closet in the morning, boom, I take it off the end, boom, there's a whole rack of, you know, at least 30 or so V-necks, boom, comes right off, takes me that long, I put it on, I'm ready to rock. I don't sit there and think about, is it the blue, is it the white, is it the checkered? You know, when I'm speaking and I've got on a suit, blue or gray, sometimes black. Doesn't take me much time. Boom, boom, boom. Why? I got better things to do. I know what I'm going to eat every single day. You know, I have automated my mundane decisions so that I can gather back part of that 18%. Does that make sense to you? Now, you take 33% that the average individual spends sleeping their entire life away, and you take 18% that they spend showering, shaving, and shitting, excuse me, showering, shaving, and eating, and fixing their hair, and that's in there too, and that's 51%, guys, come on, that's 51% of your entire life is spent sleeping and deciding what to wear and eating. What could you do with at least a portion of that 51% back to do something productive? 51% of your life is gone, not of your day, of your life is gone right there. Now, remember I said that 4 hours of TV was 25% of your waking life based on the average? Well, let's add that back in now. And now 75% of your entire life is gone. 75% of your entire life, sleeping, eating, primping, and watching TV. So you got 25% of your life left. Are you starting to see how staggering this is? Are you starting to understand why most people come to the end of it all and they have the greatest pain? You know what the greatest pain is? The pain of regret. To look back and go, oh my God, here I am. Here, it went so fast, and I didn't accomplish anything that I wanted to accomplish. I didn't even do a fraction of the things that I wanted to do. Is it any wonder that most leave life with the music still in them? You know, Thoreau said most people lead lives of quiet desperation and they go to the grave with a song still in them. What'd you do?
I watched some good TV programs. Ate some good food, got some good sleep. Wore some fine threads. Okay.
Let that not be you. Let that not be you. Look, you've got to get focused. You've got to develop your will because focus is a byproduct of your willpower. And most people have very, very weak willpower muscles. I told you this in our last episode. I'll tell you again, put this in your notes. Here's the definition of willpower. It's the ability to give yourself a command and then follow it. I'm going to get up at 4 a.m. tomorrow and I'm going to be in the gym by 6. That's what I did today. You know, when the alarm goes off at 4 a.m., a lot of days I don't feel like getting up. A lot of days I think, oh my God, you know, I'm already beating the average of 33%. I maybe could catch another hour. No, willpower says when I give myself a command, I'm going to follow it. I'm going to do it. You got to develop the will. Let me give you a couple of principles. A couple of principles for strengthening your will. You ready? Write these down. First thing you must do is you must commit to yourself that you're going to remove all distractions from your working space. Remove all distractions from your working space. Number two, and I'm going to talk more specifically about what that means. I'll give you some examples in a moment. This is tough. It's a tough one. If you work in an office, it's difficult. If you work at home, it's difficult. But you've got to remove all distractions because you know what? You get one shot at this, man. You get one shot at this lifetime. You get one shot at 2017. Take your shot. Remove all distractions. Number two, you got to realize that research shows, this is critical, write this down. Research proves you can only stay, you know, in focused flow for a maximum of 90 minutes. 90 minutes. Okay, now that's presupposing you get there. It takes a lot of doing to get there. But once you get there, you can only stay there for a maximum of 90 minutes. So I'm going to encourage you to become a sprinter. And let me give you a metaphor. If you ever watch the Olympics, you see the distance runners, the long distance runners, they look like running Q-tips, right? I mean, they're all gaunt and they're all sucked up and they're, you know, they're emaciated and they're running and they're running and they're running, right? All right, now you look at the sprinters or the speed skaters. You seen these guys and gals? Their legs are like tree trunks. Huge muscular legs. You look at the long distance runner, beanpole. You look at the sprinter, huge muscular legs. Why? Hard, all out for a short amount of time. Everything you got, bam! Sprinter, boom! Distance runner. Right? Get the difference? All right, you're going to have to become a sprinter. I'm going to challenge you to become a sprinter. And what research proves that you can only sprint for 90 minutes. You can only sprint. You get the metaphor? You following? You can sprint for 90 minutes. And so what you must do, and this takes willpower, it takes discipline, is you must schedule your sprints. You're going to go for 90 minutes with no distractions, no interruption. And then you've got to discipline yourself to get up. And that's where you go for a walk. That's where you go for a workout. That's where you grab some water. That's where you do some planks. That's one of my favorite. When I have to get up from my desk after a 90-minute sprint and go to the restroom and get some water, then I do planks. Because what I'm going to suggest to you is that the time in between your sprints has to be productive. Take a power nap for 20 minutes. Do something productive. This is not an excuse after a 90-minute sprint to scroll through your Facebook feed or to watch television or to do idle chit-chat. No, no, this is your life. This is 2017. You got too many big things to accomplish in your life and in this world. You with me? And so you're going to sprint for 90 minutes, and then you're going to get up, and you're going to stretch. Yoga, that's another great one. You know, do some yoga. Stretch the muscles out, because when you sit for a long time, you get tight and you get bound up. Stretch your hamstrings. Do something productive. Grab something to eat. It's not a license to play video games. Seriously? Or to surf the internet. You see, this takes discipline, and most people's minds are about as disciplined as a small puppy. Right? I got a small puppy. You've maybe seen pictures of her. Her name is Flo, and she's right over there in her kennel because, you know, she would be a distraction right now, and I don't need distractions. I'm right here with you. And yet, you know, she's all over the place. She's got more energy than, you know, than I would like her to have, quite frankly. I mean, she's like all over the place. And so that's cute in a puppy. It's cute maybe in a child. It's very unattractive in an adult. And it's very counterproductive. Make 2017 your commitment to willpower, to focus, laser focus. There's obviously a lot more strategies and techniques that I can give you. And I'm going to reel it in because I don't want this to go too long here today. You know, we can talk about this some more. You can ask me questions down below. But let me give you six laser focus tips. You're going to want to write these down. Number one, shut down computer programs. When you're going into flow, shut down your other computer programs. Number two, turn off and silence and or silence your phone. Are you serious, James? Yes, I'm serious. Turn off or silence your phone. You know, you roll back the clock 20 years, we didn't have these things. And I love my phone. I use it. It's productive for me. But you've got to be the master of it. It can't be the master of you. You know, everybody's stuff is the most important stuff in their mind. Everybody who's going to interrupt you thinks their thing is more important than yours. You got to take control of your own life. Shut down or at least silence your phone. Now, shut your door or have regular office hours. This is critically important if you're working from home with your family. You know, you're going to have a conversation. It's important in a working environment, too. You're going to have a conversation with your family, though, and say, look, you know, Daddy, Mommy is working on this project, and when the door is closed, you know, and you say, James, I don't have a door. Okay, then put on a ball cap. All right, when the ball cap is on, it means no interruptions. All right, I'll take it off after 90 minutes. But when you walk in the room, if the door is closed, you don't knock, right? Or if the ball cap is on or the flag is up or whatever you want to do, you don't interrupt because Mommy and Daddy are up to greatness. And by the way, this is how you become an example of possibility to your children and to your family. Care enough about them to care enough about what you're doing and become an example of possibility to them. Shut your door. Have regular office hours. Turn off your notifications, you know. Nothing is more distracting than the little notifications that pop up, you know, in the corner of your computer screen. Blah, blah, said someone on Facebook. And blah, blah, said someone on Facebook. You know, and it knocks you out of flow. Even if you don't acknowledge it and click on it, it knocks you out of flow because you're right here and it's like, bing. You're done. 20 minutes. 20 minutes it takes you to get back. Turn off notifications. Number five is schedule 90-minute sprints. Things that get scheduled get accomplished. Well, James, I don't like living by a schedule. I'm kind of a free spirit. I like to just go with the flow. Okay? Knock yourself out. Knock yourself out and see what that's going to do for you come this time next year. Things that get scheduled get accomplished. And then 6, automate mundane decisions. Move this. Psychology calls it automaticity. You move it. You hand it over to your unconscious. You develop a habit. You habituate it. You know, I can stumble downstairs at 4 a.m. when I've had not enough sleep, and I can fix my morning drink, you know, half asleep, because I know exactly what's going in it, and my conscious mind doesn't do it. My unconscious mind does it. Tablespoon of apple cider vinegar, tablespoon of organic lemon juice. I mean, you know, add water. It just happens. Automate mundane decisions. I told you what I do with my wardrobe. You may not want to go there, okay? That's cool. But do what you can do to automate those mundane decisions. Simplify your life so that you have more energy and more willpower to put it towards your greatness, so that you can make great decisions when the time comes and you don't experience what psychologists call decision fatigue by making all these mundane decisions about how you're going to fix your hair and what you're going to eat for lunch and how you're going to whip it up and how you're going to wear what you're going to wear and all those kinds of things that mean nothing and they take 18% of your entire life. All right, I told you I might push some buttons. And hopefully I've given you some things to think about. Did we have a question? Or are we over time? We're over time. I'll come back and get it in the after, because this has gone a little bit longer than I like to keep it. Hey, download the free gift, please. It's my gift to you, because I want you to have the best year ever in 2017. Click the link above. Put in the coupon code, $197 value, absolutely free, because you are a part of my community. I hope I've given you some things to think about, and I'll put them into practice. Until we speak again, as always, stay awake, love life, and be epic.